We are delighted to have Dr. Harish Hande with us today as our first guest speaker. Dr. Harish Hande is the founder and CEO of Selco Foundation and also the founder of Selco India. He is a renewable energy entrepreneur with over 25 years of grassroots experience in meeting the energy needs of underserved populations. His work catalyzes aspiring clean energy enterprises that deploy and maintain sustainable solutions for underserved communities and has impacted over 2 million people so far. In recognition for his vision and efforts, he has received several awards, including the Ramon Magsaysay Award for 2011, Skoll Award for Social Entrepreneurship in 2018, and the Zaid Future Energy Prize in 2015. Thanks again for taking out time and joining us today. Over to you, Dr. Harish.
Thank you, Bhagyashree. I hope you're able to see me.
Yes.
Thanks so much for giving this opportunity, Bhagyashree, for speaking and also changing the, and I apologize for changing the time so often. So I will, it's strange times that we all have to speak this way and without a physical interaction or physical, that makes it sometimes very, very difficult. Though people are saying that this is the right mode, saves a lot of things, but I'm not sure whether I buy into such, in terms of that, that if that's the only future we should all look at. Anyway, coming back to our topic today, I think it's very critical when, interestingly, when people look at livelihood opportunities for the rural areas, the traditional form of a typical middle class or upper middle class in India would think about rural economy being only agriculture, farm related. Yes, it's very critical that 70% of it is linked to that. But there are other, so many other livelihood opportunities that exist, whether it's a rotary rolling machine, whether it's a pottery making, or whether it's a cold storage system that somebody needs to actually look at, or whether you run an enterprise of as much of a scale that you see from an urban area. But what happens today is why these opportunities get missed out. Number one, the appropriate ecosystem that is required for such enterprises and such innovations to happen is missing. For example, when we look at, I'll first talk about the negatives and what is missing, and then and go into what we need to do from a co-partnership to make those negatives to positives in a manner that solutions will come up. And solutions today, the post-COVID, will come up in a manner that makes it resilient, that all the livelihoods, opportunities that we are creating in the rural areas are not only sustainable from a financial perspective for the people who started, but also resilient from similar crises. You see, what happens today is that because of a crisis like this COVID or a crisis like climate change, which are similar negatives in both sides, the biggest impact that is felt of COVID or climate change is always the poor, and especially in the rural areas. You destroy basically the ecosystem of reliability of when are the monsoons going to happen, the drought, and secondly, the second part is obviously the lack of trust in financial mechanisms to actually finance many of the rural clients on a larger, longer term basis. Like we all talk about microfinance and say microfinance for rural areas in many ways, unless and until we do not create long-term finance for the poor to actually own assets, we are not going to get people out of poverty. And more so now in a condition that we need to put in more risk into the rural areas, of risk capital into the rural areas, that leads to asset creation by the poor, that will, so that they have a resilience to get out of power, keep falling into poverty. And that's what happens. Many of the livelihood opportunities that people, the poor, especially the poor, have, are not resilient enough for, say, a strike or a bund that is 5 days or 4 days or 3 days. Forget COVID. COVID is actually going to push back millions back into poverty and into severe poverty. That will be more expensive for all of us to get them out in the next 10-15 days if we do not relook at what actually livelihood means and how the partnership between the organizations that we are all talking about needs to come in place. Because today we want to talk in projects, even CSR, right? It's all projects. Or, okay, how do we finish CSR money by March 31st? That's, I think we need to get away from this March 31st syndrome, and we also need to get away from the concept of it's a project, it's a program, we need to get people out of poverty and for problems that have been there for generations. So it's going to take time. You cannot do it within 6 months, 1 year. It's a process of laying a foundation. So that's why the partnership between organizations is very clear. In the rural areas, what happens is, number one, there's a lack of risk capital for rural youth to actually innovate. When it comes to rural youth, when it comes to innovation of livelihoods, we always think well-qualified, educated people can innovate. And we need to put R&D money into it, or we need to put R&D money into their, institutions or elite institutions. Who owns the problem? Unfortunately, today, we put in R&D capital of innovation into the non-farm sector livelihood applications into people who don't own the farm, own the problem. For example, if I really need to solve for a pottery maker machine, how come a pottery maker is never involved in the solution provider? Why is he not called an expert to be part of a team that actually can work on a pottery machine? Oh, he's not qualified. Qualified for whose definition? You know, it's such ironical, right? Pottery wall wheel. The so-called wheel was invented by an uneducated, illiterate man millions of years ago, because uneducation and illiteracy is defined by the way we define it. Risk capital, number one, for R&D. Number two, many of the rural area institutions like the ITIs, the RUTSET, the vocational schools, we always assume that the kids who come to these institutions are going to be taught in a manner that they will then work for somebody else. So it's all about skills, motor winding, repair shop, electrical. It's not repair shop, sorry, repairing of wiring and plumbing, and so that they can work for an industry. Why don't we create capital, risk capital in the rural area, in these ITIs and vocational schools, where so many of the students would want to become entrepreneurs, want to become innovators. We need to convert many of these institutions, the ITIs and the vocational schools, as centers of innovation and incubation. Once we convert them into centers of innovation and incubation, push in CSR and other pots of money to be that equivalent to STEP that you have in IITs, these then become where there are, out of every 100 students, I bet there are 15 to 20% of them are entrepreneurs and 5 to 8% of them are innovators. We need to create those appropriate risk capital for these youngsters to innovate on the non-farm, like whether you talk about silk weaving, roti rolling, a pressure pump for a motorcycle repair shop, or all the equipment that is needed by a barber shop, innovations in bakery material that a rural baker actually want. And there are thousands of non-farm livelihoods like a kirana shop or a printer and a printer Xerox shop, there where innovations need to happen in technology, delivery models, and financial models together, all three of them. And for that, we need to create appropriate centers of innovation and incubation. And that's very critical for us as a partnership, whether it's CSR money that many of the organizations are involved here, whether it's a government money to relook at similar like the STEP, philanthropic organizations that actually can put in money into these rural, if we have to truly create rural co-creation labs, I would seriously advise them, can we create thousands of co-creation labs or makerspace labs in the vocational schools like the RootSet and the ITIs of this country? Put in that philanthropic money into that. Number four is investment capital, both in terms of equity and debt. Unfortunately, what happens is there is no instruments of equity for the traditional speaking people, whether it's a Kannada speaker or whether it's a Oriya speaker, whether it's a Manipuri speaker. We do not have risk capital in terms of equity to be invested into those type of entrepreneurs, and that needs to happen. Fourth is debt. Debt cannot be purely just on microfinance, but debt should be long-term finance. If I have to create, for example, I want to own a cold storage system, which is an infrastructure on behalf, just like how India would have infrastructure in terms of road, where roads are financed over a period of 30 years at 0% finance. Similar, somebody who needs to own an asset on a longer term needs to have a finance over 5 to 8 years at lower interest rates. And that's the only point where the poor can actually own assets and get out of poverty. But today what happens is we look at the poor only in terms of providing service in terms of labor force. We never look at the intellectual capacity of the poor to create assets and the intellectual capacity of the poor to actually contribute in a much more positive form for the country as a whole. And for that to happen, the both farm and non-farm activities or livelihoods opportunities need to be created in a manner that they create the opportunities, not us sitting in the middle class. They innovate because they own the problems. Today, when we talk about the migrants, yes, it's very critical for us to create those livelihood opportunities because thousands of migrants have gone back. Unfortunately, the way we have now defined the word migrant and the way we have defined the skill set, as if we know what all the migrant skill set is, and we are paintbrushing the migrants as one. These are migrants who are from 0 days old in age to 75 years old. Can you imagine, are we going to create entrepreneurship or skill sets for people who have been in so-called, some parts are civils in the service sector for 45 years? A 45, 50 year old laborer who's been working in some building complex in Bangalore, going back to Gulbarga, are you going to at that age convert him into an entrepreneur? We need to pray. There are 12 to 15 year old kids who have gone back who have absolutely no skills in the ecosystem of rural areas. We need to rethink how can we create new opportunities for not only for the migrants who have gone back, but also to diffuse the social tension that might occur between the people who have returned back and people who have been already there for many years. How do we co-create those institutions in the rural area, co-create financial abilities for both the migrants and the non-migrants to get those skill sets so that the rural livelihoods. We have, frankly, as a country, we need to map out what are the opportunities, whether it is ready, it's we need to come up with modernization. It's not, sometimes what happens, we don't like the word traditional. You don't like the word secondhand, but pre-owned is a great word, right? The question is, how do you package? How do you relook at, and when we look at traditional, is there a market? Would any of the people who are on the webinar will be putting their kid into a skill set that is traditional? We need to ask those questions ourselves. What is actually traditional? What is, so that, because it's easier to put up an income generating activity plan on the poor because it's there, because we don't own the problem. We ourselves, who are all on the webinar, start needing to own a problem, and that's when livelihood opportunities becomes a co-creation. And the first partner in the co-creation has to be the people for whom we are actually developing these livelihoods. How do we build in equal channels that the communities, for example, or the migrant community of Gulbarga is part of this webinar or part of the co-creation in in that. So I would say we have a huge opportunity of a co-creation where academic institutions, philanthropic organizations, investors of capital for equity and debt, financial institutions, commercial banks, RRBs, and local cooperatives, training institutes need to be reconverted from training to being training incubator and innovative institutions in the rural areas. That's the link that we need to create. And then how do we today in the rural areas create islands of excellence of every 100 kilometers? What COVID has actually pushed us to rethink is that you have to rethink your market areas, your areas of innovation where you can actually sustain. That whole decentralized operations need to actually come in place for today. And how do we create islands of between 100 to 150 kilometers? What are those livelihoods that could strive between 100 to 150 kilometers? And for that, how do you train? How do you look at decentralized approach? Because COVID and climate crisis have actually increased the whole barriers of long distance, have actually created the barriers of whether it's social distancing and the transaction cost. But it's very glamorous when you talk about locally grown, organic, for the middle class and our upper middle class. Why can't we rethink that? That is the norm in which society was in many years, and in the name of what do you call it? Oh, let's push it everywhere. Let's scale it up. Let's sell hundreds and millions. And that has led to disparities. I'm glad the team has come up with this type of webinars, because that's critical to think how do you decentralize livelihoods, create islands of excellence, innovation, decentralize innovation, decentralize opportunity. And the best is not only you remove poverty on a long-term basis, but also create resilience for the poor, not to step back into work. And the most important is you truly create an inclusive society where a poor kid in a rural area or a poor migrant's kid is able to say, I can be an innovator, I can be an entrepreneur. And that hopefully will lead to less disparities and equal sharing of wealth. And that's why it's so critical to have these co-creation labs. It's that where we are co-creating with the best of the technologies in the world, innovators in the world, and actually the communities. And our best success would be of this lab is in 10 years, we switch and saying that the community is actually the innovator and we listen to them in a webinar. Thank you, Bhagyashree, for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Hande, for such an engaging and insightful talk. I'm sure all participants would also agree. And also the topics that you touched upon is exactly what we also resonate with and has been the main intent while we formed the collective. We have a few questions for you, and I'll just read it out. So the first question that we have is, if you could highlight 3 to 4 key areas for the partners that we have through the collective, like the CSR, philanthropy, NGO, innovators, in terms of like which these 3 to 4 areas they could look upon in terms of strengthening the rural economy.
See, one area I request the CSR, one is to ask the CSR and philanthropic organization to move away from this project-based funding. Okay. Get away from project-based funding, come on. And don't be pressurized that we need to, March 31st, March, yes, look at a 3-year, 4-year program. See, you know, I mean, I mean, as we keep saying that the biggest subsidy Google got, Bhagyashree, is the internet. If nobody of us paid for the internet, or the US military and didn't pay for the internet, Google would not have succeeded. And CSR money is the most expensive money in the world. And because it can actually define the market for the future, it's like you are building the roads, you're building the foundation of a building of a 21 story. If your foundation is weak, the building will fall. And that's exactly what has happened in COVID, that many of the buildings fell. The philanthropic money, it's not only CSR, but overall philanthropic money and equity money, debt money have been a failure, because How did it suddenly fall just because you had a COVID of 1 month of a civilization that was millions of years? So we need to see whether the... So I would request 4 things. One is partners getting together. Financial resources can come later. And you define your principles and what way together and say, where would we co-leverage our money? What is the most important? And what is the most risk that nobody else will put in the money for? Number two is really converting the rural areas into centers of innovation, where the poorer kids are the innovators. The people who come in are the entrepreneurs. Just like any, when you put into any elite institution where we define the industry principles of what it is needed, or where innovators have to, what are the next set of innovations? How can we today, for example, our success would be where a rural ITI or a vocational school is where I would like to have an expert from or a webinar with. How did you define a silk weaving machine? How did you actually innovate on a butter churner, for example? How did you relook at a refrigeration system for a kirana shop? I think those are where I would, one is focus on innovation, and purely on innovation where there's an integral form. Third is, how can the group look at risk capital, opening, unlocking long-term finance in the banks? If I say, for example, if you have 10 lakhs, 20 lakhs, 30 lakhs, first you should look at, not like, okay, I'm going to subsidize, say and a typical example of 30 home lighting systems to be in. What we typically do is put 30 home lighting system, they are poor. No, your money could have actually been used as a fixed deposit in a bank. And against that, the bank would have financed 30, today 30. And as people keep paying back, it's 60. So your money that was initially allocated for 30 would have led to 150 households in 5 years. I would request one more thing is, how do you co-create with people from across sectors, in a sense that you should have a doctor in your co-creation team, you should have an architect, you have to have a philanthropist, you have to have an anthropologist, because the social, economic, and financial and environmental systems, the ecosystems are very different. So you need people who can think anthropology, who can think finance, and those creation of it's more less about technology. Technology will happen. The dissemination of technology and financial models will happen. Once we start relooking at the teams that we ourselves, do we have the breadth of looking at the social of dynamics? That is a third part I would seriously consider co-creating, is that, do we really have the right people to actually even co-create? And that I would prioritize on that. And fourth is obviously putting up a large fund for high risk equity where capital for entrepreneurs who don't speak English as their primary language. Because today, if you look at equity documents also don't exist in non-English speaking languages, right? So I think those are the 4 steps I would look at for the collabs to actually start doing it in the rural areas.